Good evening. I'll call this council meeting order, the workshop for October 15th to order at 7 p.m. One housekeeping item first. Councilors, you have all been provided a updated calendar for our meetings for the rest of the month of October. Should all have a copy. It's a white copy. Anybody have any questions on that?
No.
Okay, great. First item on the agenda is Chief Sears, and it has to do with the purchasing of two vehicles. Oh, wait a minute. Because we went into a non-public first, and then the minutes was messed up, so we need to do the minutes first. And I was just looking at Councilor Manatelli, and you were going to say something. I appreciate it.
Motion to approve the October 1st, 2008 business meeting minutes.
Second.
Councilor Quox?
Quox. Next to the last page, number 12, vote 70. Should be 7-0. Motion carries.
Next to the last page? Come on.
So it says 70-0, just a typo. And then under number 4, request a thermal imaging camera. Just a question of the word. The thermal imaging camera, the department had been over 10 years old. Is over 10 years old. The thermal imaging camera, the department.
Should be are over 10 years old.
Is
over 10. Is over 10 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And that was it.
Erica, can we get these pages numbered next time? You usually do, don't you? Yeah, I thought you did. Yeah. Numbering system's not working, huh? Thanks, Erica. Any other comments on the minutes? This one, I had one though. Okay. Yeah, I know. I thought I saw something here. That's why I was checking for the last time. All right, roll call on the minutes.
Councilor Quox?
Aye.
Councilor Bergeron?
Aye.
Councilor Branch?
Aye.
Councilor Poskey?
Aye.
Councilor Minutelli?
Aye.
Councilor Carr?
Aye.
Chairman Glennon?
Aye.
Okay. Chief Sears, you're up.
That time of year again to come to before the council and request a withdrawal from the CIP to purchase a police vehicle. This year, the CIP, we replace a line car, black and white, every year, and it's rotated out after 5 years. And every third year, we replace one of the secondary vehicles, so we get a 9 or 10 year life span out of a detective's vehicle or the vehicle I drive or the utility vehicle that we use in the wintertime. This year is the third year of the cycle, and it's the detective's vehicle is scheduled to be replaced. We've had it for 10 years, over 100,000 miles on it. We're starting to get some frame rot. And it's time to look at replacing it. I've spec'd out a regular black and white car for the line car, and I've spec'd out a Ford Taurus six-cylinder with better gas mileage for the unmarked car for the detectives. I also, in specing out the outfit for the cars, which also comes out of the CIP, I was able to use quite a bit of the equipment that's fairly new in the other cars, so the outfit costs are down this year. So for the purchase price and to totally outfit both vehicles, it would be in the area of $54,000. I realize it needs to be a resolution. The reason that I'm coming to you in October and not in July, when the budget kicked in, is that in July, there weren't any vehicles available. Ford was in the tool-down stages of production in between the 2008 and 2009 models, and the dealers didn't have any vehicles in the police packages. I've been waiting until the dealer called me and said that they're now coming in with the 2009s. Both vehicles are the state bid price, and we'd be getting both of them from Irwin's in Irwin Motors in Laconia.
Councilors, have any questions, Chief, on this issue? Councilor LaBranche?
Chief, if I remember correctly, was it a year or two ago that you mentioned that there were grants available for the radio upgrades and stuff like that on vehicles? Do you recall which one I'm talking about? Is that not available still, or is this a discounted rate that you're putting in for the actual equipment?
Actually, we received the grants, and they outfitted four of our five cars. Last year, we had to outlay about $16,000 to put the computers and all the stuff into the car, over and above the car. This year, we're just replacing power packs and some of the items that won't fit in a 2009 that it fit in a 2008. So we're doing it for about $3,000.
Okay. Can you just refresh my memory what the name of that grant was?
Car 54. Project 54.
Project 54. Thank you.
We've maintained a very good relationship with them, and as a matter of fact, they're going to be bringing us the next generation of technology here very shortly. As soon as we move our antennas, they're going to be giving us live vehicle data right in the cars. I just spoke to UNH today, and they're all set to go for us.
Thank you.
Totally free.
Councilor Pawlowski?
I'd like to make a motion to approve the withdrawal from the CIP Police Vehicle Fund to the $254,000 for purchase of two new vehicles.
Second.
I thought we were going to do this at a business meeting. What a resolution.
Oh. Okay, we'll wait for the resolution. I'll withdraw my motion.
Is that
motion
appropriate?
Yeah.
So we'll get the resolution.
I'll withdraw my motion.
Okay, thank you. Do you have a question?
GCS, I was just wondering, why are we getting a six-cylinder Taurus and the other one's a Crown Victoria? What's the difference?
The Crown Victorias are a lot larger car. They have the room to put somebody in handcuffs in the back seat. Those are the models that you see that most police agencies are driving right now. Ford makes them in a police package. They do have an eight-cylinder engine in them, but they are heavy-duty drivetrain, heavy-duty suspension, and they're built to be police cars. We don't need to do that for the detective's car. We can go with something that's a little more economical on gas and smaller. It doesn't require putting a prisoner in the back.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. If there's no other questions on the vehicles, while we have you here, we have your bi-monthly report from the police department. Does anybody have any questions for the chief on that while we've got his attention? Okay. I have one. The transmitter site relocation. On the water tower, is that the one near the Hocker Road?
Mm-hmm.
So are we going to be running out of room? Because I thought we were looking at putting up something near AT&T and some other towers.
What we're going to be doing is putting up an antenna on the top of the tower so that we have a better, we're able to provide better reception to the communities that we dispatch for.
No, I understand all that, but
we have plenty of room.
We have plenty of room, so it's not going to interfere with.
Correct.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, the outfits that have already been promised there have already got their spots light out, and we're just going to be off in a corner someplace and out of the way.
Gee, I would think you could trump them, though.
We're just going to be happy to be up high.
Yeah.
The higher the signal, the better it is.
Okay. And I also noticed that you have made comments about the work in the downtown, how well that Rick Malaski, Julie Glover, and Joe Seavey and the Severino team have done, and I think we all echo those sentiments also.
They've been great to work with.
Yeah, they've done an excellent job. They really have. All right. Thanks, Chief. Anybody else have questions for the chief? Okay.
Thank you, Bruno.
Thank you. The councils are aware of this, but the public is not aware of this. We've had some agenda changes. The administration has provided us a copy. And item number 4 and 5, which was a line of credit from Don Pennell, they're still working on that with our town treasurer. And tax rate projection, I was told this evening from the town administrator, they're waiting for some latest information coming in on that also. So those two items will be tabled to another meeting. That's out of the way. All right. And our town clerk, Becky Benvenuti, is here to talk about the presidential elections and the role of the council during that process. And Becky, please come up.
Good evening. I did bring some up-to-the-minute statistics about the presidential election. We are 20 days away. From November 4th, and it's a very busy, hectic time. I did have the opportunity last week at the New Hampshire City and Town Clerks Association to spend, along with the rest of my peers, a couple of days with Secretary of State William Gardner and Assistant Attorney General Jim Kennedy, who both came personally and worked with the group for 1.5 days just on specifically the presidential election. And the reason being is that they are already seeing and anticipating that this being the most highly scrutinized presidential election that we've ever had, particularly in New Hampshire, because New Hampshire, as you know, is first in the nation in the primary, and it really has a lot of the spotlight nationwide. And we did have that recount for the presidential primary last January, which on a positive note did provide the state with a lot of information about things that were flaws and minor flaws in the processes all across the state. So they're really working with the towns to really scrutinize their processes, try to be thinking about everything concerning the election ahead of time, so that that we come out with high marks. To that end, they did ask us to bring back and strongly encourage. They have put on the Secretary of State's website, and you'll see right at the top of your memo there, I put the web address, and they have come up with some training specifically for selectmen, which you would be town council, for the moderator, for the town clerk, and for the supervisors of the checklist. And they have asked us to please bring this back to our communities and strongly encourage the selectmen, town councilors, to take a look at that. You don't have to go through it step by step. There are 23 lessons there, but you can skip around and you can, you know, look at things that you may not be as familiar with, particularly for new councilors. And if you want to just skip right to the back of the handout that I presented to you, just to give you some ideas of the magnitude of the presidential election here in Newmarket. In 2004, we did have 44,268 ballots were cast. In addition, 366 absentee ballots were cast. And on that day alone, we registered 820 new voters at the poll. Thinking ahead, the town clerk's office kind of mounted a town-wide register to vote early campaign, and I would like to thank the businesses in town for assisting us with letting us put up signs and get information out. And I think that's been pretty successful. We've to date, in the last 30 days, we've already registered 225 new voters. We may still have 820 voters on election day, but at least we won't have 1,000. is how we're looking at that. We've, as of today, we have distributed 249 absentee ballots. We do have a large number of military overseas and around the country that we, fortunately, you know, with technology, we have email addresses, and we've communicated, and we've confirmed that they are receiving their ballots. Some of them have already come back, so we're pleased with that. As far as the town council duties for election days, I'm not going to go into the specifics of it, but I did just want to touch base on just the general areas that where your responsibilities lie. The under RSA 658-2, each town political committee is authorized to appoint what they call election inspectors, and that's the pool of people that the moderator can pull the ballot clerks from. Those people are sworn in and have office for 2 years. If a town political committee fails to do that, then the responsibility lies with the town council to appoint those election inspectors of election. So we've provided for you the list of, we have 13 Democrats and 13 Republicans. There has to be one from, you know, a balanced number from each party. The tables, the check-in tables, have two ballot clerks sitting at each table, one Republican, one Democrat. And we've provided for you a list of 13 names of Democrats and 13 names of Republicans. And I've put on your handout there what the action is, the wording of the action that would be required to appoint these people for a two-year period as inspectors of elections. And from this list, we will, the moderator will be able to choose the ballot clerks. We, speaking of ballot clerks, normally we have two check-in tables. We will be having five check-in tables to help the lines move along. Also, the New Hampshire Constitution requires selectmen to attend elections that when the governor, council, or senators are chosen. The responsibility of the polling place lies with the town council, the selection of the polling place, which will be at the junior senior high school this year, the lighting, the furnishing of the supplies, flag inside, flag outside, the guardrail ensuring that the voting booth and the ballot box are protected from people, you know, only people that are inside the guardrail can access, can come within 6 feet of the of those the booths or the box. We do have a ballot counting machine. You are required to post a warrant, and I believe that Administrator Winowski has that for you all to sign later this evening so that that can be posted in the required time for the town. Accessibility of polling place, the Help America Vote Act, which was enacted in 2002, is very specific with regard to providing a special voting booth for elderly or people with disabilities, enabling them to vote. It also has very specific rules and requirements for both parking and ingress and egress in and out of the polling area. And we're working, the Public Works Department is helping ensure that the school meets all of those requirements. The counting of the ballots, as you know, you all participate in the counting of the ballots once the polls have closed. And I would like to just point out to you, I'm not sure if you are all aware, but legislation was passed this past year which does away with straight ticket voting. And it's the first time in 110 years in New Hampshire that there won't be the opportunity for someone to come in and vote straight Democratic ticket or straight Republican ticket. And there's quite a concern that the public may not be aware or understand that and may try to mark the ballots still in that mode of trying to show they want to vote straight ticket. So that may, we may have a little longer counting period than normal as a result of that. The Secretary of State has promised us, though, that they're going to try to get some educational tools out where we can really help people to realize that they have to fill in the oval for every candidate. And then securing the ballots. Once the ballots are all counted, it's the town council's job to ensure that the ballots are all secured, the cast, the uncast, the canceled, the challenged, all of those, and then deliver them to me, the town clerk. And I, before I, you know, in case you have any questions, before I take that, though, I really, I would like to express special appreciation. We have an awesome group of supervisors of the checklist here in town. They've had a tremendous burden of coming up to speed and learning the new statewide voter database software program. It's amazing. The town moderator, who does all of this above and beyond, you know, his regular job, our public works department, our IT department, we had to set up special phone lines over at the school to ensure access to this handicap voting booth, to our police department, who's going to be there from beginning to end and then carry the results of the election so that they get to Concord, and also to the unsung heroes in my office, Donna, Becky, and Debbie, who are just absolutely going crazy right now trying to keep up with all this, and just they really do a great job. So if you do have any questions, I'd be happy to answer it. If not, I look forward to spending the day with you on November 4th.
Are there any questions? Why are you not hitting your button?
Becky, are all seven councilors expected to be there all day?
I can only tell you what the New Hampshire Constitution says. And the Constitution says that the selectmen must attend an election where governor, senator, are elected.
That was basically what I was going to ask. Does one have to be there at all times? Do we rotate in and out, or?
I think maybe you could, talk about that and come up with something reasonable. I'm sure it would be
designate some time.
Yeah, I can't imagine that there's a town in the state where, unless there's three selectmen and they all, are there, recognizing that most selectmen and town councilors do have full-time jobs or part-time jobs on the side. I'm sure that as long as it's reasonable, making the best effort, I would suspect would be.
Because of the wording, it says to attend. Would you think it would say to be present? We had to be there all day.
Right.
Elsa? Councilor LaBranche?
Seeing as how this is a workshop, can we still make the motion on the action required?
Yeah, I think this is the only time we have to do that. It's an exception, I would think, yeah.
Would you let me make it?
Yep, go ahead.
Okay, I make a motion to appoint the following 13 Democrats and 13 Republicans as inspectors of election for the town of Newmarket for a two-year period, beginning November 1st, 2008, or until a successor is appointed and qualified. Do we need to name all? We don't need to name them, correct?
As set forth
as
on this
as
piece
stated.
Of paper.
Yeah. All of these.
She has a copy.
Second.
All right, any discussion on this before we move into a vote on that? Roll call, please.
Councilor Quox.
Aye.
Councilor Bergeron.
Aye.
Councilor LaBranche.
Aye.
Councilor Plasky.
Aye.
Councilor Minutelli.
Aye.
Councilor Carr?
Aye.
Chairman Glennon?
Aye. Now, Becky, we do have to sign something here this evening, too, of which
yes.
You have that. Don't you want all in one copy?
Has the three-hole punch in it.
Yeah.
Is that acceptable? So.
But you don't want seven copies. You wouldn't want
one. Just one copy. So if the chair wishes to take his copy there and
yeah. Okay.
I'll sign it.
No hanging chairs. No hanging chairs, yeah.
And I will also, Chairman Glennon, I will also make sure that this list, the 13 Democrats and the 13 Republicans, is made public. It will be in our office.
Can we get it on the website so people can see it?
Absolutely.
Okay. Is there two places where we have to sign? Because I'm looking here and here, right?
Correct.
Okay.
Do we all have to sign it?
Yes.
Just indulge me for a moment while I sign this and pass it on. Okay. I don't see any other lights for Becky. So at this point, you're free to go.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Becky. Okay, let me go back here. Okay, 4 and 5 we're skipping. Nope, yeah, 4 and 5, but we've got to go to 3, and I believe Rick Malosky is here to try to talk like Julie. Or
I was told that he's not to ask for any money.
Oh, okay. Did you get that from him or from
Julie?
Julie.
Strict orders.
Yeah.
Everything's going good. Everything's on schedule pretty much. Still looking for November 7th. They finished paving over to Elm Street today. They'll be setting curbing on Monday, starting the sidewalks from the Eagles down to Central Street. Colby's coming in on the 23rd of October to start the brickwork, and he'll be pouring the rest of the sidewalks. And the last week in November, they'll start hopefully paving in front of the Morelli Strip from Central Street to the post office. But aside from that, no big surprises or anything to can answer any questions, I guess. But traffic's been really screwed up. Been a lot happening, the paving and stuff. But that stuff last Friday was not the project. It was the railroad. Had nothing to do with us.
That was a good message that Julie got out too. I have a quick question. When do we expect traffic to go both ways again?
November 7th is the target date for that.
Is that target date?
Yeah.
Okay. Councilor LaBranche?
Rick, last time Julie was in, she had mentioned that they may have been looking for like a one-week extension on completion or substantial completion, I believe, is...
Yeah, substantial completion is November 7th. There was talk of possibly going out to the 14th, but right now everything still looks pretty good.
Okay. So
I mean, I don't think that's going to happen, but if the weather changes, we've been having nice weather and stuff, so they haven't lost too many days. A few days here and there, but they've got a lot of people in town right now. And
okay. Thanks.
Going at it.
Any other questions for Rick / Julie?
One other thing I could just throw out there, I believe you guys got a copy of the notice on the, we're going to have to do a drawdown on the Lamprey for an inspection of the dam. So there'll be a public hearing here on the 3rd of November.
Yep.
And Fishing Game, DES, everybody will be on board with that. It'll take a couple days, obviously, to do the drawdown and get an inspection. We expect it, with the weather conditions like they are now and the flows on the river, a couple days to get it down, and we want to start that on the 10th. Everybody's on board so far. We just have to conduct this public hearing. It's something that DES has requested us to do.
So. And that's going to be here at the Town Hall?
November 3rd at 7 p.m.
7 p.m. and auditorium?
I believe so, and we need to have it televised too, I believe.
Okay. And do you take care of the marquee and Channel 13 and all of that? Okay.
We're doing a press release. I think you guys have copies.
It's been approved, and I think it's on its way out.
Well, certainly the councils are invited to attend, but it's not essential that the councils be there, right?
No, it's they did this in Durham just recently. If you noticed, when you went to Durham, the river was low. They had to do the same thing there. Uh-huh. I guess when they had theirs, I mean, obviously, I think it's a little different with Mill Pond, but you have to, something they require you to do to hold it.
Councilor Pulaski?
Rick, I have one question on that. I vaguely understand what a drawdown is. In back of the agent's house, the river there, how low will that be there?
It'll be pretty low.
Because a few years back, a car went into the river and there were divers down there, and I distinctly remember this diver coming up and saying, "Wow, you should see all the refrigerators and stoves down there."
Yeah.
And my question on that is, if the river is that low, that would be a great opportunity to haul that stuff out of there. Has that been taken into consideration?
That's not something that we discussed, and I don't know if there's permits and all that needed to do those types of things.
Okay.
But it's something that could be brought up at the public hearing when DES and Fishing Game, everybody's here.
Okay, thank you.
But I don't know how low, because I've never done a drawdown, so I don't know how, but I would assume it's going to be pretty low.
Yeah.
Just a brook, I would assume.
Okay, thank you.
No other questions? Thanks, Rick. Okay, so we're going to skip 4 and 5. And before we go to 6, I want to inform the council that the Historical District Commission, this is a update. This is not a request to pass anything. Some of you new councils are not aware that the previous council had asked the Historical District Commission to go out and do certain things, which was to notify people who live within the sort of federal government delineation of what a historical district is, and to have some public meetings. And they're here tonight to say what they've done and what progress they've made so far. So the chairman of the Heritage Historic District Commission is Philip LePage, and he's here to speak to us this evening.
Good evening. Last night we presented essentially the same topic to the planning board. Judy Ryan co-presented with me. You all received a packet this week from the Advisory Heritage Commission with a cover letter from me, proposed historic district map, the proposed ordinance, and the proposed regulations. Now, back in May, we sent notices to all property owners in the proposed historic district and invited them to a public forum to discuss. We had presenters from the Division of Historical Resources, Nadine Peterson. I'd like to thank her. Maggie Steer from the New Hampshire Preservation Alliance. If I could do a poll of the council, were any of you there, or did you see the presentation on Channel 13?
I was there.
Okay.
I was there.
Yeah,
sorry, 13.
Sorry. Okay. So you pretty much have an idea of where we're coming from. Now, other people I'd like to thank in this process before I go too far. At the end of that meeting, we asked for volunteers from the interested parties and property owners who attended, and we had 15 volunteers, and we ended up with a core group of 8 people: Michael Dowling, Darylyn Griffin, Bob Turcott, Bernard and Anita Gordon, Mike Hoffman, and Martin McKinsey. We held many subsequent meetings with these parties and the members of the Advisory Heritage Commission, and what you see is the result of a consensus of this core working group. Now, Mike, I'm going to ask Mike Provo to come up at some point here, too, to talk about the history. I'll give you a little bit of background, though. The Newmarket Service Club, back in 1981, was responsible for the initial National Register Historic District. Tons and tons of work went into getting that established and approved. Mike, would you like to talk about that right now? So,
Before you go any further, if I could interject something. Come on up, Mike. I'm not sure if you made it clear that you did fulfill the requirement of the council on notifying everybody, and that included all the businesses within the historical district. So everybody was notified.
I
want to make
indeed,
that clear.
That is indeed correct. Yes,
thank you.
Absolutely. Mike, if you want to give some background going back to the 1980s.
Sure. Actually, the process started in 1976 with the Newmarket Service Club, which was a precursor to the NBA. It was a group of business people in the downtown that went out and privately raised funds to hire the Thorson Group that did the study for the new life for downtown Newmarket. And part of that process was to hire historic consultant and preservationist Richard Candy from York, who did all of the research work, and the National Register Historic District was established. The way it works is that the state of New Hampshire Division of Historic Resource is actually the one that approves and recommends to the National Register for local historic districts, and it's the National Park Service that oversees this. So basically, since 1980, property owners have been advised that they are in a National Register Historic District, and it has been in existence in the town of Newmarket. It was the intention of the businesses people at the time that along with that would be the option of going forward, and as an economic development tool and a preservation tool for the community, that they would establish a historic district commission and oversight area and officially adopt it on the local level. Basically, the idea at the time was that we did not want to see more of our blocks in downtown removed and have a post office sitting there that matches our downtown so wonderfully. And that we also were looking at a demolition ordinance that would at least put a hold on somebody wanting to demolish a downtown property so that it could be reviewed and it could be, you know, decided, was it important to the fabric of the downtown and the community? And basically, it was the idea of keeping Newmarket special so that we didn't wake up someday and be anyplace USA. And I think it's especially important right now, personally, just to sidetrack a bit, that we think about this because we are in the throes of attracting a developer to invest $21 million in our mills downtown in a project. We've just spent millions of dollars improving our Main Street, and I think it's time to really have this discussion. It is an economic development tool. It does provide access to National Register funds. Becoming a CLG, Certified Local Government, also gets you preservation tools from New Hampshire Preservation Alliance. The first thing that's asked for tax credit projects for people that are investing in properties is, are you in a National Register Historic District and are you listed as a contributing property? And that's already been decided. All of that work has been done. So there is an impetus and a tax credit process already in existence for people that do significant investment in the downtown. That, coupled with other tools that are available to communities like RSA 79E, which is a local enabling ordinance that encourages people to invest in their properties, can all be used as an economic development tool. Having had experience with this process, the whole idea behind it is it does actually not only preserve the area, but it encourages people to invest in it and improve the downtown and actually increases the values of the properties over time. I guess that's it, unless you have any questions.
Yeah, I just want to ask you, Mike, when you said that last comment about increase the values of your property, however, it does not increase the tax of your property because...
No. Basically, that's it becomes important. Very, very...
Because there's a legislation there to prevent that from happening.
Right. Well, that's RSA 79E. And basically, you know, I think the big thing with the discussion, any historic district discussion is going to be contentious, but it's really important that the community have a district established with ordinances that fit the district that you have. Having come from a community that had two separate and distinct historic districts, one that I worked in had, it was out in the Monadnock region, had a 17th century pristine collection of buildings that was the old town center, and they also had a very eclectic historic district that was the downtown district, and they had two separate and distinct sets of guidelines because you can't have the same thing for both areas. And I think you have to look at the expansive buildings that you have and things like that, and it's important to realize that it's the community itself that delineates what these ordinances are, and you design your own ordinance for your community. And the biggest part of the process is debunking all of the myths about historic districts and educating the general public about what does and does not happen with a historic district. So.
One follow-up question. Have you seen, in your experience as an executive director of the Main Street, such in Japri and other areas, have you seen when a historical district has been designed and set up, any negative impact to it?
Actually, I think the easiest way to answer that question is we've all traveled all over the place. We've all gone to different places. If you think of the communities that you really like and you've really enjoyed that have a great sense of place and a great sense of their architecture and their heritage, I will almost guarantee you 9 times out of 10 that that's a National Register Historic District that's overseen by a local ordinance. Places like Newburyport, Amesbury. Actually, right now I'm working in Dover. Dover, unfortunately, cannot have a National Register Historic District in their downtown, core downtown, because of all of the urban renewal that went on. In Jaffrey, it was not a negative. We actually only had one vote against the district when we established the local downtown district. But what did happen is that it increased a lot of awareness about what was in the district, what was there for properties. And when realtors were starting to list properties, they were listing the history with the properties and stuff behind it too. So you attract a different kind of investor. And you know, the investors that you have, people are not going to invest money in rehabbing properties unless they know the properties on either side of them are also going to be protected. You know, and that kind of thing. So, and it is contentious. It does take a lot of discussion. It's a long process. It's not one you go into lightly. but it's one that started 32 years ago with the businesses downtown, and I think that's important to realize. And I think its time has come with the mill and the investment that the community has made. But I think we need input from everybody in the downtown in developing the ordinance, and that's part of the whole process. That's why they're here tonight.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Mike.
In response to some of the feedback that we got last night from the planning board and members of the public, we're hard at work at scheduling at least two additional public educational forums. This will be in addition to the public hearings that the planning board and the council will ultimately hold as this topic is discussed in the future. If I could, Newmarket Tomorrow Committee Report 2000. Very dusty at this point, but I dug up a copy. Members of the committee, John Algren, Victor Azzi, Tom Blake, Debbie Bork, Rod Bowles, Sean Cahill, Walter Cheney Jr., Renan Cohen, Steve Coolidge, L. Forbes Getchell, Nancy Goodwin, Jim Grammas, Chris Hawkins, Karen Johns, Nick Popov, Louise Roy, Preston Samuel, Richard Shelton, and Mark Vesicus. They did a lot of work. This committee met for months and months, and they came up with a consensus. If I could recommend that each counselor obtain a copy of this, I'm sure it's still available at Town Hall for a quick review. But if I could read a passage from the aesthetics portion on page 7. We realize that we are fortunate to have an historic downtown that is largely intact. Our downtown is a crown jewel that needs to be protected. It is important to maintain the mills and other historic buildings. It is important to enhance the views of the Lamprey River and Heron Point and to improve access to public spaces along the river. It is important that residents of Newmarket see downtown as their hometown. We talked a lot about what we liked and disliked about other downtown renovation projects. Their recommendations, I'm fast-forwarding here, balance historical integrity with complementary styles and buildings and landscape designs. Restoration efforts should enhance existing buildings, views, and streetscapes, not transform them. Architects and designers need to listen and respond to community perceptions. So clearly, with respect to the mission of the Advisory Heritage Commission, we were quickly backed up shortly after the establishment of the Advisory Heritage Commission by the findings of the Newmarket Tomorrow Committee. Judy, if I could ask you to come up at this point, and discuss the process on...
The process has been long and long-term. I say we have been working for a number of years on this. We have been to the council, previous councils, and obviously some of the members here have been on those councils, and had that discussion, advised us to come back to you with a complete package. It does not mean that the package as it is entirety would be passed in comprehensive.
Excuse me.
You have to ask them, I don't know.
Okay, excuse me, somebody talking.
There are three pieces of this. This is an ordinance. It is an overlay to the designated districts, by the zoning district. So it must come forward from the planning board to the council for approval. So that there is the ordinance itself that establishes the Historic District Commission. There is the map. The map that was included in your packet is inclusive of the industrial and commercial district that is approved currently by the National Register of Historic Places by the Department of Interior. And there is a section there at the northern end for proposed new district that we as a town can approve. In addition to that, there is the draft guidelines that our group has worked on over the summer with numerous meetings with volunteers from the town who came to the meeting on May 22nd in this room. And that is our draft proposal that we are bringing forward and hope to work with you, but also with the planning board, as it will have to come from the planning board to the council for approval. We have worked on this for a number of years. The initial drafts, some of you will remember, came through in 2005, and it is finally refined to what we think is a reasonable and low-keyed guideline for the regulations that would be in place if adopted. We did look at a number of other towns. We looked at Exeter, Somersworth, Durham, Keene. That was about it, right? The Keene regulations, which are also in draft and have not been adopted, were actually the most helpful in looking at the format that we laid out, because we were saying these are the things that we would encourage, these are the things we should like, not will. These are the things that do not require. And I'm sure there's some others in there that we missed. I mean, that's why we need a bigger team, really, to look at it. So that's what the packet we have presented to you reflects, and this is draft. But we want to look forward to moving with the insight and additional comments from not only the public, but the planning board, to present that finally to the council. But our role here tonight is to say that this process moves forward and requires of you to let us move forward with the planning board to work on a final product. So if there are any questions, I'd be happy to ask them. I'm sure you would, too.
Okay, absolutely. Interestingly, the Keene draft is up to about 100 pages already. We've spared you a whole lot of reading. And kudos to the committee, the volunteers that worked with us on developing what we are proposing for you. In terms of starting educational process here, it was one of the things that, in addition to selling, the planning board mentioned education. And I'm going to read two paragraphs, if you just bear with me, from the New Hampshire Division of Historical Resources. What are historic districts good for anyway? Daniel Webster once said that a person who doesn't respect the past isn't performing his or her duty to the future. Perhaps it was Webster's eloquence that inspired the 1963 session of the New Hampshire General Court when it established New Hampshire's historic district enabling legislation. The legislators could have been very straightforward and perfectly legal by saying something prosaic like, New Hampshire municipalities may establish historic districts according to the following procedures. What they actually did say was, the preservation of structures and places of historic and architectural value is hereby declared to be a public purpose. The heritage of the municipality will be safeguarded by preserving a district in the municipality which reflects elements of its cultural, social, economic, political, and architectural history, conserving property values in such a district, fostering civic beauty, strengthening the local economy, and promoting the use of a historic district for the education, pleasure, and welfare of the citizens of the municipality. That enabling legislation was further added to back in 1992, and they added more to it. But the reason I'm here, personally, I was born in this town. My parents were born in this town. Both of my grandparents, all of my grandparents, immigrated to this town, exclusively to this town, from Canada and Austria. I love this town. I'd like to see it preserved for the future. We can't protect everything. Clearly, a lot of it is already gone, but that's why I'm here. That's why I've been on this mission since the year 2000, and I must thank people like the Service Club before me who did all of the heavy-duty work back in the 70s when they did the inventory, which was the inventory is reflected in the master plan, by the way. You might want to take a look at that, too. So I guess the next step, just asking you to ask the planning board to initiate the process. The draft regulations, your package, have not been approved by legal counsel in the town. Diane is ready to do that, to send it to the firm they use. Is it Bates and Mitchell or, at the...
Laconia.
At the, as soon as the council advises of such, so that will start the process. And then please look forward to a couple of public forums to be held with representatives from the New Hampshire Division of Historical Resources. We'll probably get some additional speakers next time around, different speakers for variety. We will attempt to more publicly notice this so that this, in addition to the property owners in the proposed district, it is more townwide, and hopefully we'll have better attendance, and there'll be several opportunities for questions to be answered as we move forward. Any questions?
Councilor
Yes.
Walk.
Bill, could you reiterate what you said last night to the planning board regarding the clock at the church and how if everything was all set up, they'd be
Oh, yes, good point, good point. Certified local government status is something that can be achieved after the establishment of an historic district, and one of the members of the impromptu clock committee we have up and running now checked with the New Hampshire Division of Historic Resources, and one of their first questions was, do you have CLG status? And of course, our representative had to answer no. Well, a lot of the resources that would have been available to restore this town clock were immediately became unavailable because of the lack of that CLG status. And I talked to Ed a little bit about this today. We will be doing some CIP for the clock purposes, but we're looking at $40,000 perhaps to get that up and running and the faces restored. So just another example of the value of an historic district with enabling legislation.
And I believe there's also loans and grants for any businesses, any building that's run as a business in the district. There's loans available to them and grants.
I believe it's Section 179 that was mentioned at the forum, and I'm not terribly familiar with that, but that enabling legislation allows for people who substantially invest in the restoration of historic property to get tax abatements, immediate tax abatements, prorated over several years, but they get their, it's like free repairs ultimately, so.
Clarify that 79E, the abatements are only on the amount that's expended to improve the property, not on the general tax base. So,
thank you. Good point.
And also, just to clarify something, in order to establish a district, everyone had a vote on it back at the time, and there was no negative votes that went forward to Concord. So it was a unanimous passing of the historic district by the property owners back at that time. So,
okay. Councilor LaBranche.
Just a couple of quick questions. First of all, you did mention that this hadn't gone through legal.
Yes.
You speaking in terms of the ordinance itself or the ordinance and the regulations?
The ordinance and the regulations would need to be reviewed.
Okay, so.
The map was pretty much laid out back in the 1980s, so that's cast in stone essentially, although there are some proposed additions to that, but.
Right. Now, understanding that you also mentioned that you're going to have a couple of other informational sessions mm-hmm. with hopefully the owners of property in this district. At that time, will you have the draft regulations available for them to view?
So oh, yes, absolutely. Absolutely,
what
yes,
exactly
because
is going on?
These are indeed going to be available here at Town Hall, effective immediately, or as effective yesterday. Diane Hardy's office is making them available to any interested parties. It was just a matter of waiting until our little work group wrapped it up, so, and we were able to present it to Diane Hardy. So.
But these haven't been approved by legal yet?
No. That would
so
be
you'd
that
probably
would be
want to wait until they've been verified through legal, correct, before you'd let anybody have copies of these? No?
No, not necessarily. They're modeled after Clay Mitchell and Diane Hardy worked on these, very adept individuals, so they're probably in very good shape, so it's not going to take much tweaking to get them in a form that will pass muster with a legal team, so.
Thank you.
You have a question?
There could also be through the public forums with the draft available for people to review prior to the public forums, just like last night Planning Board alternate Rick McMinimum made a remark that there wasn't any criteria in there regarding any type of an emergency repair to a building, how that would be handled. So I'm sure there'll be through the public forum and input from boards and the public things that they might want to add to this and delete from it as well.
Absolutely. This is going to go through legal counsel several times before it it becomes law per se, if it ever makes it that far. And we are still, receiving input last evening, again, like as you indicated, emergency repairs. I did happen to check the existing ordinances that we use to, assist in modeling some of our language, and I didn't see any that addressed emergency repairs, but it doesn't mean that we can't, so.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Any other questions? So at this point, you're looking for direction from the council to send this officially on to the planning board for a review by the planning board?
Council action, yes.
Okay, would somebody like to put that in the form of a motion? Councilor Pulaski.
I'd like to make a motion that we pass this on to the planning board for review, for legal review and any other work as necessary.
Can you please state what it is we're sending on?
Excuse me. The Newmarket Historic District Commission draft regulations.
And ordinance or just draft?
And ordinance.
And ordinance. Okay. Do I have a second on that?
Second.
Any further discussion? Roll call. Mr. Winowski, please.
Councilor Quox.
Aye.
Councilor Bergeron.
Aye.
Councilor LaBranch.
Aye.
Councilor Pulaski.
Aye.
Councilman Utelli.
Aye.
Councilor Carr.
Aye.
Chairman Glennon.
Aye. Great job, folks. All the people who have worked on this, thank you. Okay. Next item is, I gotta put that over there. Disabled veterans exemption. I got a call on this months ago, and I haven't really done anything with it because everything else going on. I'm going to ask Mr. Winowski to, it's actually addressed to you, so I'll let you explain how it affects everything. And one of the things, even though it does state here that they would like to have it go into effect in 2009, I did speak with Mr. Winowski earlier this evening prior to the meeting, and it would be no problem if the council should decide to enact it and have it go forward, because our tax rate has not been set as of yet. So according to the tax assessor and then Mr. Winowski, it's an M1. What is it? We need to fill out a new MS1?
Something?
MS1, yeah. MS1. And that can be done, and that goes on to Department of Revenue. Is that where it goes? Yeah. And prior to the tax rate being set, and there's still time to do that. So if we could do that, if we want to do that, we can do that. And if you would explain how this all works. The council sees it, but I want the public to understand it, too.
Sure. What this relates to is any veteran who has a 100% service-related disability, totally and permanently disabled veterans, of which the town has five individuals. And the standard credit is $500 that is presently provided by the town. It can go as high as... it can be raised to a range of $701 to $2,000. And at the present time, there is a request, I should say that the standard credit for veterans is $500. So if you're a veteran in the town of Newmarket and you meet the conditions as outlined in the state RSA, you receive $500. The service-related disability can go as high as $2,000. So I apologize for that. And at the present time, the increase would be $1,300 if the town was to adopt it, because presently we provide a $700 veterans service connection disability. If the council was to adopt this, there would be five veterans who were entitled to it, $1,300 additional. So the total cost to the town would be $6,500, and this is the exemption comes off of what they pay. So Mr. Blaze had indicated, the assessor had indicated that it, and he notes here, if the town chooses to adopt the change, he would recommend that the revision be effective the tax year 2009. In talking with the chair, I said that it would be up to the council to choose whether or not wish to incorporate it into this year's tax $6,500. It gets into the mix, and it would be money that obviously would go on to the tax base, but it's a small amount at this point. That nutshell is.
Are there any questions on this? Does everybody understand it?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Do we have a motion to move this forward to adopt the tax credit for veterans 100% service connection disability to the maximum amount, which is the $2,000? You make that motion? Okay, thank you. Second, Mr. Menicelli. And with effective date for November of this year, so they can get that tax break right away?
It's 2008.
2008, yeah.
Did you read the bottom?
I read that, yeah. We just talked about that. So we have a motion, we have a second. Any further discussion on this? Can I have a roll call, please?
Council Quox?
Aye.
Council Bergeron?
Aye.
Council LaBranche?
Aye.
Council Boskey?
Aye.
Council Menutelli?
Aye.
Council Carr?
Aye.
Chairman Glennon?
Aye. So this will send the paperwork in for this tax period.
Correct.
All right. Thank you. So that passed. And let's see, where are we next? Okay. Let me get set up here. Bear with me, folks. I'm just getting organized here. Okay, before we get to, while we're in the item number 8, clarification of allegations raised on October 1st of 2008. Before we get into that, the council has all received a memo from our attorney dated October 10, 2008. Before we read this, I need a vote from the council to release this information as a public document. Would someone so like to make that motion?
Release which information?
The October 10th memo from FX Bruton, our legal counsel.
So moved. Second.
Any discussion on it? Roll call, please.
Council Quox?
I think I'll abstain.
Yes, you need to abstain.
Yeah, I'm
sorry.
Abstain.
Council Bergeron?
Aye.
Council LaBranche?
Aye.
Council Plasky?
Nay.
Council Minutelli?
Aye.
Council Carr?
Aye.
Chairman Glennon?
Aye. Now I'll need a motion to allow me to read the document to the public.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Council Bergeron?
Aye.
Council LaBranche?
Aye.
Council Plasky?
Aye.
Council Minutelli?
Aye.
Council Carr?
Aye.
Chairman Glennon?
Aye. Before I read that document, I would like a vote of the council to release the document from FX Bruton dated October 7th of 2008. My understanding, someone please correct me if I'm wrong, at the last meeting of October 8th, we read just the three paragraphs. There was a vote on that to allow the reading of the three paragraphs that our legal counsel recommended. And I don't believe we voted to release the whole document. And there have been some questions to some of the citizens would like a copy of it. Councilor LaBranche?
I do not believe that it was a specific motion to release a certain part of the document. It was a motion to release the document.
And I don't have the minutes to that meeting, so I can't verify that. But my understanding, and that was just my recollection. If anybody else wants to weigh in on this, because I thought it was just supposed to be three paragraphs. Councilor?
I concur with Mr. LaBranche.
Okay.
We wanted the entire document.
Okay, but you're out of order. I need to recognize Councilor Pulaski.
As I recall from that non-meeting, we actually did take a vote to read the three paragraphs that we all discussed and chose those three paragraphs to be read at the meeting that night on October 8th. We did not choose to release the whole document. Thank you.
Mr. Menicelli?
Well, I
don't have a problem releasing. I just don't know how we did it.
I don't, my recollection is that the motion was vaguely worded, and the problem is decisions aren't supposed to be made in non-meetings. So when we made the decision in the public forum, yeah, I don't think we specified it, so I wouldn't have any problem making another motion here tonight to clarify the situation.
Okay, so you want to make that motion? Go ahead, I'm sorry. I was just going to recognize another counselor.
Yeah,
go ahead,
no,
make
I,
the motion.
Well, I'll make a motion to release the October 7th, 2008 document in its entirety, which was read to the public at the October 8th special meeting.
Okay. We have a second on that?
Second.
Councilor LaBranche?
I'm all set.
You're all set. Okay. So if there's no further discussion on that, let's do a roll call to release the minutes of October 7th, 2008 from our attorney, F.S. Bruton.
Councilor Bergeron?
Aye.
Councilor LaBranche?
Aye.
Councilor Poskey?
Aye.
Councilor Minutelli?
Aye.
Councilor Carr?
Aye.
Chairman Glennon?
Aye. It will be available for you. All right. Now, the reason why I put down is probably a bad choice of words, clarification of allegations raised on October 1st of 2008. Probably not the best word, clarification, because I've gotten some questions. What do you really mean by that? What I meant by that was I wanted to clarify why we did not vote that night to do an investigation. That is contained in this October 10th memo, of which I will read to the public. It is dated October 10th, 2008, to Dana Glennon, Chairman, Newmarket Town Council, 186 Main Street, Newmarket, New Hampshire. Dear Chairman Glennon, as a follow-up to our letter dated October 7th, 2008, please accept this letter as our opinion with respect to the current procedures regarding the initiative petition, which has previously been submitted to the town council, and as well as the comments and complaints made by Mrs. Jennifer Jarvis during a recent town council meeting. In our opinion, the town council can still vote to move forward with an investigation under section 3.15 of the town charter. However, our advice is that the board not proceed with any such investigation as the initiative petition has been filed. Although the petition, in our opinion, is defective, the petitioners are not precluded from submitting a revised petition. Based upon a high probability that a revised petition will be submitted, it is our opinion that the council should not proceed to an investigation at this time, as the council would have to serve as fact finders with respect to any public hearing that would arise as a result of validly submitted initiative petition. Under section 8.2 of the town charter, a public hearing is required. Thus, to the extent that a revised initiative petition is submitted and it is determined to be valid by the town clerk, there will in fact be a public hearing scheduled on the matter, and the town council will serve as fact finders. Based upon that possibility, again, we would advise that the town council defer its decision as to whether to conduct investigation to section 3.15. To the extent that the town council does come to the conclusion that a revised petition is not going to be filed, any one of the town councils is free to make a motion to entertain conducting an investigation pursuant to section 3.15 of the town charter. Should you have any questions at all with respect to the above, please do not hesitate us. Contact us. F.S. Bruton, 3rd. So. Who was up first? Mr. Minutelli.
So moving forward, just so people know, those documents will be available to them.
Yes.
And they don't need to, I think that should clear up some confusion that had previously surfaced. And I have a question about whether or not we need to take a vote to accept the legal opinion. In other words, the status of the situation was, on October 1st, we voted to have a meeting on October 8th to discuss the allegations, and then legal opinion said not so fast, so I think we should.
Yeah, I would agree. I would concur, and I think that's what you were trying to tell me in the email, and
yes.
I wasn't quite getting it.
I understand.
Apologize for that. So there should be a motion, I would say, that says we, going forward, until another petition or whatever happens, I wouldn't say another petition, but whatever happens going forward, a motion should be made to accept the legal opinion that was rendered this evening, or rendered on October 10th, I should say, and read this evening. So somebody want to make that motion to accept legal's opinion dated of October 10th, not to go into an investigation at this time.
I'll still move that.
I'll second.
Any further discussion? Okay, roll call, please.
Councilor Bergeron?
Aye.
Councilor Branch?
Aye.
Councilor Plasky?
Could we read the motion, please?
Yeah. Do you want to accept the council's recommendation this evening on the letter dated October 10th not to proceed with an investigation?
Aye.
Councilor Minutelli?
Aye.
Councilor Carr?
Aye.
Chairman Glennon?
Aye. And I apologize. Councilor Branch, you had your light on.
Yeah,
I didn't recognize it.
I'm just trying to sort through the timeline here. You just read a document dated October 10th relating to the October 8th meeting and utilizing that document as the reason why we didn't do anything on October 8th. Am I correct in?
No. October 8th, he also specified in his recommendation not to proceed with an investigation. And there were some people in the public that didn't quite understand. So we got this one as what FX had said, more in layman's terms.
Okay, I must have misunderstood you the first time. Thank you.
Mr. Minutelli, Councilor Minutelli.
Are we done with the vote, with the roll call?
Yeah, it passed.
I was just going to ask about how, and express some concern that I've expressed already about how we're receiving legal opinions. Because I have reviewed the town charter, and section 4.14 says the town council shall engage as needed such attorneys as are deemed in the best interest of the town to provide legal advice to the council, the administrator, town departments, boards, and other agencies and represent the town in any legal proceedings. Such attorneys shall, on council direction, perform any other duties prescribed by this charter or by ordinance. And the concern I'm expressing is that, particularly with respect to this action, I know the town administrator had involved himself on October 3rd to get a legal opinion. And you, Mr. Chair, I've been told, suggested that that's not appropriate and directed him not to communicate with legal counsel.
Not quite that way, though, if I could clarify that.
Let me just finish my concerns. And so what I'm saying is I think the charter ponders that when the council needs a legal opinion, that the council will vote on that, and it'll be a council decision, not one necessarily made by the chair. So I'm expressing this to the council, to you, and hope that in the future when we need legal opinion, that'll be a decision that's made by the council.
Okay. I just want to clarify one aspect of that. I did not tell Mr. Winalski not to contact the attorney. He originally had already done that. My suggestion was perhaps he should stay out of this, because it will involve the administrator and personnel, the staff, if there is an investigation. And when I had that conversation with him, you agreed with that also. In addition to that, when I spoke with FX, asking him for procedures, what will be the procedure, how do we go forward? I mentioned to him also what I had asked of Mr. Winalski, and he concurred. That makes sense, he says. It does make sense. So now going forward, the chairman, in the past, there have been chairmen in the past who have had direct contact with FX, or the law firm, I should say, not just FX. And some councilors chair have not. There have been some that have on a regular basis, and I've actually recently have been able to obtain some documents of a council chair, going back to 2004, from the month of September through the month of December, who have had conversations with legal counsel on a variety of subjects. Now, do we know whether they had approval from the council? I don't know, but I can dare to say I was on the council at that point, and I don't believe that every single time a chairman would speak, they would say, well, I spoke with FX today, this is what I was told, that also got permission from the council. So you've got to, I think, at some point, if we have to have a meeting every single time to get a, I mean, there are some instances, yes, where it's going to go through the council and get legal opinion. And I'm not saying that that should not be the case. But this particular case, yes, I did. I went ahead and asked for what would be the procedures for us to follow going forward so I can come back to the council and inform the council of what those procedures were. Normally, yes, the administrator probably would do that, but because the administrator was directly involved, and perhaps in some of these allegations, that was the reason why I asked him to stay out of it. If you have a follow-up question, you'd like some.
I was just going to say that I think that the going forward, I think the charter is clear. I think we need to take a vote in the future anytime legal counsel is necessary to be engaged.
And I don't have a problem with that. I do not have a problem with that. Mr. Wadowski?
Yeah, I just want to state that the purpose of my call to town council was because it was sort of this gray area. My question to him when I did call him was to indicate in the first instance the Jen Jarvis had come in here, had made a series of concerns raised relative to the conduct of the counselor, and how would the council be going about this? Because I felt that the council needed some kind of guidance as where we were going, and that's basically what my conversation was. I had looked at the charter. I had seen that there was one section. I mentioned it to a town council. And, you know, the discussion was, get me the information, because I said that we now had in our possessions the remarks of Jen Jarvis, which I faxed to him, and he said he would look through and give the council a letter by the following Monday. And that's when you had called and indicated you had wished that I had called you so we could have had the discussion, but asked me to step back as it was a council issue, to which I said, that's fine.
Thank you for clarifying that. If there's no other questions on that, I'd like to move on to nominations and appointments and elections. Now, we received two tonight, and I'm going to defer because we just got these, and I want to have a chance to read them, to go through them. So they will be on the next council agenda for appointments. All right, the first one up is... Well, one of them we have, by the way, is for the Black Bear Tip, and it's for Rod Bowles. He doesn't live in the Tip, Black Bear Tip. He lives in Maplecrest, I understand, so he would not even be qualified. So we can... Mr. Wadowski, would you let him know that he's in a memo of some sort, that he's not qualified, because... And the Black Bear Tip, my understanding, is a five-member board, and it's full now. Okay. All right. The first one I have, I hope you all have the same, is a appointment to, what's this one for? The Budget Committee?
Mm-hmm. No, it's Budget Committee. First one.
Oh, this time.
Yeah. Okay. The other concern I have here, Mr. Wadowski, is some of these are coming in with the date stamp, like Mrs. Jarvis has got her date received on October 3rd, but some of these are not. So I'm questioning how they're getting through the system without somebody stamping them. Would that be because Kathy might have been on vacation?
You know, I can't answer that question because I'm not out front that's accepting them.
Okay.
The understanding that the staff has is as they come in, they've been requested to put into the council's packet, and from there, the council would act upon them.
Right, but there should be stamped.
I'm assuming, I can't address that question.
No, I'm talking about the stamp.
Town stamp.
town stamp, yeah.
Received.
Yeah, received date. Now, I do have a question on the Budget Committee. Does the council, we don't appoint and do it, no. It is the Budget Committee that does that.
Correct.
So this has to go back to the Budget Committee.
Correct.
So that takes care of that application. Then we have an applicant who would like to be on the Riverwalk Committee, which is Rod Bowles, Robert Bowles, but he's listed as
Roderick.
Walter
Roderick.
Yeah. So, what's the term? Say again, not stamp. I would send this back to him and ask him what term is he looking for.
And we need terms on them.
Yeah, we need terms. Mr. Winowski?
I guess the question becomes, is there a vacancy that exists on the Riverwalk? And if so...
There's two, I think.
So would it be appropriate for the council to consider to appoint him as a member? And the most recent year would be the end of his term. So if the term is 2011, then he would be appointed in 2011. I guess to send this back to an individual in the community and say, please tell me how long you want to be on this, I think it's kind of, I don't want to say disingenuous, but it's like, you know, I don't think the council should be a paper chef for, you know, to residents who are interested.
And we don't have another application, so it's not like we're trying to decide which one is going to get which one. So,
right.
All right, I don't have a problem with that. It was a technicality. All right, nomination for Mr. Bowles?
Nominate Rod Bowles for the Riverwalk Committee for a term of whatever is available.
Second.
Okay. Mr. Branch of Light is on.
That's okay.
All right. Any discussion? And he's not in the audience, so you could address this if you'd like to. So roll call, please.
Council Quox?
Nay.
Council Bergeron?
Aye.
Council LaBranch?
Aye.
Council Plasky?
Nay.
Council Minutelli?
Aye.
Council Carr?
Aye.
Council Chairman Glennon?
Nay. The ayes have it. So it was 4-3. Okay. You'll get a letter out to him, please?
Yes.
Okay. Whoops. I got to get this in here. Okay. Mrs. Jarvis is the only one that did it right. She has it stamped October 3rd. This is her second request. Do I have a nomination for the Heritage Advisory Commission for Mrs. Jarvis, which I don't see a date to. Do you happen to know, Mrs. Jarvis, what the terms are on those?
It's an alternate position, so I'm not sure. You don't have any regular positions available. It's only an alternate.
Okay.
And I believe there are two, so.
Okay. Thank you. Do I have a nomination for Mrs. Jarvis to serve on the Heritage Advisory Commission as a alternate?
There's two advisory positions, alternate positions.
Wait,
open.
Did you know when the date is for the question? You're the chair.
So moved on the nomination.
I'll second that.
Any discussions on this? Okay, roll call, please.
Council Quox?
Whoops, I'm sorry, we have discussion. Mr. Council Palofsky.
Thank you. Last meeting, Mrs. Jarvis so kindly gave us Resolution 2000-12 relating to the establishment of an Advisory Heritage Commission. Part of that document says, now therefore be resolved, the Town of Newmarket, New Hampshire Town Council, to create an advisory heritage commission to protect and preserve our precious history, significant resources, pursuant to New Hampshire RSA 673, more thoroughly detailed in RSA 674:44A and B, organization and powers. The Heritage Commission will provide for the historic recognition, use and protection of resources, tangible and intangible, permanently man-made, that are valued for their historic, cultural, aesthetic, or community significance with their natural
built or cultural context. In the past, and I can specifically recall Councilor Jarvis, Mrs. Jarvis's position on the Historic District Commission as being very negative, and this is not an exact quote, but I believe it was said that they just want to regulate all the businesses. And the people that have been on the Advisory Heritage Commission and prior to them have worked very hard to obviously establish a commission, a historic district commission, as evidenced by the councilors that signed resolution 2012. And due to Ms. Jarvis's comments and past statements as a councilor against the historic district, and this being the purpose of the Advisory Heritage Commission, I don't think she is qualified to be on this. And to be honest with you, I just think that she is the Antichrist of historic preservation. Thank you.
Councilor LaBranche?
I was not aware there was a prerequisite to be in favor and be in agreement with everything that took place on a specific board. If that were the case, there's individuals, or at least one individual, on the Advisory Heritage Commission right now that at a downtown TIF meeting stated that the mills should be torn down. So, you know, that statement needs to play into the factor also, because this is just not good local government to take people that are willing to invest their time and efforts into seeing things through and voicing their opinions and being shot down.
Councilor Bergeron.
Councilor Plosky, aren't you concerned about this council becoming a dog and pony show? Aren't you just kind of creating the same thing that you are against by those kinds of statements?
Councilor Bergeron, we are discussing this nomination, not my comments. Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to allow the applicant to come up and speak if she'd like.
I'm all set.
Okay, thank you. Roll call, please.
Councilor Quox.
Nay.
Councilor Bergeron.
Aye.
Councilor LaBranche.
Aye.
Councilor Plosky.
Nay.
Councilor Minutelli.
Aye.
Councilor Carr.
Nay.
Chairman Glennon.
Nay. Motion fails.
Point of order?
Sure.
I would just, since Councilor Plosky was so generous to let us know why he voted nay, I've been asked this question in the past by Councilor Quox, I'd like to have the reasons for the other nays, if at all possible.
Per the charter, we do not have to give reasons. We only have to give reasons when we are.
That's being a coward.
No, it's not, Councilor LaBranche, and I do not appreciate that comment.
Take me off the committee.
I will point you as out of order if you make another comment like that. All right, let's move on, folks. Okay, Energy Audit. I keep on saying audit. Energy Committee. Of Robert Levitt, is that how you pronounce that?
Levitt.
Thank you. And this is for 3 number of years residents. Mr. Winowski, how did we stagger those out? 3-year terms?
Yes.
Okay, so we have people already, right?
Correct.
Okay, so
be probably a 2-year term in order to be able to balance it.
Does anybody want to make a nomination for Mr. Levitt to serve on the Energy Committee?
I would like to make a motion to appoint Robert Levitt to serve on the Energy Committee. Term expires to be determined.
Okay. Do I have a second on that?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? Oh, here's his resume. Okay, roll call, please.
Council Quox?
Aye.
Council Bergeron?
Aye.
Council LaBranch?
Aye.
Council Plasky?
Aye.
Council Minutelli?
Aye.
Council Carr?
Aye.
Chairman Glennon?
Aye. I guess it just goes without saying, but I'm going to remind you anyways, Mr. Winalski, if you could get letters out to these people.
Yes.
Thank you. Any old business? Any new business?
Are we going to do review of standing committees?
Oh, I skipped over a whole page. Right. I thought I could get through you tonight, but I guess I didn't. Yeah,
not
committees.
Not
review of standing committees and council representatives. Councilor LaBranch, you have anything on budget, CIP, or, well, energy hasn't met yet, have they?
Budget committee met last, well, we didn't meet. It was an informal meeting with the school going over the elementary budgets. We're meeting next week or joining them next week on the 23rd, I believe it is, to go over the high school budgets. Our next actual meeting isn't scheduled until, I believe, the first week in November. CIP had a brief meeting a couple of weeks ago. Mr. Fillion, Leo Fillion, was nominated the chair, and we're starting to progress with that. And the Energy Committee is still looking for members so we can get started.
So with the appointment of the individual tonight, we have now three people on there, and you're one of them, and then Clay Mitchell is another one, and then this person, right?
Yes. I don't quite recall what the resolution or the ordinance called for, but yeah, as soon as they're ready to call a meeting, I'll be there to report.
Five or seven. Okay. Question on the budget committee. Do we have a schedule yet set up for the council to review the budgets? Not yet. Okay, but that's coming.
Let's meet to the council by December 15th.
December 15th. Okay. Okay, thank you, Councilor LaBranch. Councilor Bergeron? I don't know why you don't have the school on there. But.
Forensic Audit Committee last met on Tuesday, October 7th. We've completed a final review of the document after the attorney, James Wheat, has given his comments and recommendations. The final document should be given to the attorney by Thursday morning, now that we've done our changes. And the final report and recommendations by the attorney are tentatively scheduled to be presented to the town council on Wednesday, October 22nd.
Okay. Thank you.
Conservation Commission, we had a very successful turnout at the Heritage Festival. We gave free boat tours the Newmarket Channel to Great Bay, and there were well over 300 riders on that event. Very successful. On October 24th, we'll be hosting a combined cookout and work day at the Wigan Hill Farm for the Troop 200 Newmarket Boy Scouts, and they're going to be doing a actually helping us get rid of invasive plant species on the property. They're going to help
clean it up
with a professional helping us designate which ones are which. The tree committee is off the ground. And
really?
There are currently average.
How about in the ground?
Nothing in the ground yet, unfortunately. But the tree committee has begun. We have a mission statement. I'm currently advertising on Channel 13 for members. So if anybody out there wishes to become a part of the Newmarket Tree Committee, please call me, 659-8248. I'd be glad to have you on the committee. Some good things happening. That's it.
Thank you. Vice Chair Carr on the planning board.
All right. Tomorrow night we have a joint meeting with the planning board, the town council and the planning board, to discuss the M1 district
proposal
as written. And last night they had the regular planning board meeting. I was not there, but I did watch it. And the one thing that's going to, it was basically business as usual, but there is a proposal by a gentleman to build on a Class 6 road and that is going to be coming. I don't think we've got it today, but
yeah,
we did get it today? Okay. With the planning board's recommendation that we allow that. So that needs to be put on it.
Needs to get on our agenda.
A form of,
so we need to get on our agenda, so I'll get it on.
That needs to go on our agenda because we are the deciding factor on that.
Let me just write that down, post, because if I don't write it down, we won't get it done. Mr. Winoski, would you say that's a workshop, or do we have to do a public hearing, or?
I'd have to review the law, but I think that we should put it to a workshop and.
To a workshop, okay. Thank you. The Lamprey River Walk Committee, we had it scheduled for last Wednesday. We had to cancel it because of the council's meeting downstairs. However, Julie Glover did do some, a little bit of research. Now that the council has approved the parking and all of that issue with the landlord, people that own the eyeglass, well, what used to be the chiropractor place, and I can't think of the guy's name, and I apologize. What is it?
Is it
Costa? Something like that,
yeah.
What they're going to do is contact the, I think it's the Anderson people who are the architect that are going to now, they completed the schematics. Now they're going to move forward with the actual design and the engineering and the costing of it all. And all of that will come back to the council prior to any action taken on that, because we'd have to go off the bid. So that's what that is. And Councilor Roseanne Quarks on the Heritage Advisory.
Well, they were there here this evening, mm-hmm. and so that's everyone's fully aware of what's going on. Municipal audits meeting this month, and I haven't had a chance to talk to Rick to see what the status is for municipal waste. I guess that's done more towards contract time. But we should be getting together to discuss that, I guess, prior to the budget coming up.
Okay, thank you. And Councilor Pulaski, Channel 13, Highway Safety and Main Street Committee.
Channel 13 and Highway Public Safety have had no meetings, and Main Street Committee, I was unable to attend the last meeting.
Can I ask why there's no meetings with Channel 13?
It's been counseling, scheduling problems.
Okay, all right. But you normally meet on the regular monthly
yes.
basis? Okay, you have
monthly
the same issue I have as scheduling.
Right. Okay,
thank you. And Councilor Steve Minatelli, Downtown TIP, Open Space, Veterans Memorial.
Those three haven't met since we were last, since we last convened. The veterans are meeting next week. I'm on vacation, as you know.
That's right, yeah.
And, but what's not on there, and I thought maybe I'd update the council on, is that they're the Cable Franchise Committee. And all the councilors should have received a comparison matrix of the existing franchise agreement, the ascertainment record, and Comcast's renewal proposal, and the town's counter proposal. Basically, the status of this committee is that, well, first of all, the town's existing cable franchise agreement expired in May of 2008, and we're currently working under an extension, and that extension expires November 22nd. But we are really moving toward the end of negotiations with Comcast, and the document that was provided to all the councilors this evening was prepared by our legal counsel, and I think is a pretty complete record of the negotiations and where we're at this point. But I do think the council should probably note that the committee will be coming before you fairly soon with a complete, hopefully with a completed agreement, because the clock is ticking. I would note that it's possible, if this doesn't all get wrapped up in the next couple of weeks, it is possible to, and we've discussed this with Comcast, to get a further extension of a month or two. But we really want to get a completed deal in our hands, and they'll come in and present it to you. And I imagine you may want to have a public hearing at that point as well.
Thank you. Did you say the second extension ends on November what? 23rd?
I believe it 22nd. Ends on November 22nd.
Okay.
Is that right?
So would you want me to schedule this for a workshop or discussion for the council to review this document if there's any questions?
I think that's fine. The council can review it at their leisure. That's why it was provided.
Do you see a need, though? I mean, I won't put a lot of...
No, I don't think so. I think that we'll have a you know, recommendations. But if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Okay. Thank you. I had a conversation this evening with the town administrator regarding no minutes in these packets this time. And again, my apologies on this. I think with Kathy being in the way, it's a lot of stuff was going on last week. And I'm going to ask Mr. Winowski to explain how the minutes will now be handled going forward and see if the council concurs with that.
Well, I guess it's not a matter of the council concurring with it. The issue is that we have at the present time. Yeah, right. It's a matter of updating, and not only the council, but I guess everybody who uses the website in order to want to keep abreast of what's going on with different boards and committees. In the past, what was happening is, as minutes came in from different boards and committees, they were all draft minutes. And Kathy was not posting those until an approved minutes came back to her from the committee. So if the committee met once a month, it'd be a month lag before she would get something. The problem was that many times committees did not forward that they had adopted the committee meeting, the minutes of the prior month. And so therefore, she has been holding a stack of minutes. I have instructed her that from now on, and we drafted a letter today that was sent to all boards, committees, commissions, whatever, that when minutes are produced, that they, somewhere on it, it's a draft. When they come into the office, Kathy will upload them directly to the website. And if and when they have adopted the minutes and they've made any corrections and they send the adopted minutes, then we will just remove the old ones and we'll upload the adopted ones. That way it'll provide everybody in the community an opportunity to see all the minutes, knowing that they're draft and they might be subject to revision for whatever reason, so that people are able to keep abreast of what's going on. Because Kathy's got a stack of minutes that haven't been uploaded, and therefore people have been calling in, counselors have been talking to me about the fact the minutes aren't there, and I just made that decision, so it'll be a lot more up to date as we get the minutes in at this point. And also to indicate to committees that if they don't have a meeting, they need to send Kathy the chair should send Kathy a memo or something that indicates there was no meeting. There's been several committees that haven't had meetings for whatever reason. We just need to know so that people won't be calling in and saying, you know, in March and April there were no meetings of X committee.
Right.
And we have no idea why they didn't meet, but that if it was, you know, no quorum, no agenda, or whatever, then we would post that up there so people were aware of what's going on.
Thank you. And I'll take this same opportunity to piggyback on that and answer Councilor LaBranche's email that he sent me the other day, which was similar to some things are missing on the website. And I started to respond back to you that about 2 months ago, a month and a half ago, I had given the town administrator, and I believe he's been working on it, a pad like this that I had spent a whole Sunday morning, almost an hour and a half on the website, just going into different committees and looking to see, you know, things that were missing, such as wrong people were listed, addresses were missing, some had, some didn't, some phone numbers were missing, minutes weren't posted, agendas weren't posted, and I believe Kathy's been working on that to get that up to date. So that's the reason why I didn't respond back to you, because I was going to check with the administrator to see where we were with that process. Is that okay?
Sure.
Okay. All right. Any old business? See none. New business? Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Good evening, folks. Thank you.